Hi, I'm Fenella Kernebone, and today on The Filter, we are talking architecture.
This is Sydney's Sirius building. It's an example of what's known as Brutalist architecture, a movement that emerged out of modernism in the 1950s and was popular well into the 1970s. Embracing a raw, unapologetically concrete aesthetic, Brutalism became popular for educational buildings, tower blocks, shopping centres, and government projects like social housing, which was the purpose of Sirius when it was completed in 1980, after replacing some rundown terrace houses. But over the last 2 years, Sirius has been at the centre of a protracted battle between the state government, who have relocated the residents and intend to demolish the building, and a group called Save Our Sirius, who comprise architects, local resident groups, union bodies, and the National Trust. To explore this conflict and to look a bit deeper into the polarising subject of brutalism, I've invited Michelle Tabet, who runs a consulting firm that specialises in urban planning, Shaun Carter, the immediate past president of the New South Wales chapter of the Australian Institute of Architects and the chairman of Save Our Sirius, and Chris Johnson, a former government architect and now CEO of Urban Task Force, an organisation that represents property developers.
Just to start off with, actually, Shaun, I might begin with you. What does Sirius mean to you?
Sirius is a symbol of what the government used to believe in. I mean, we've got many social housing buildings in and around the city. Sirius was one of the most successful. Did everything right from an urban design point of view. It put the building on the street, gave it a front door to the street, gave those people a community room, and also put people of that community into that building. So they had a connection with the place already. This is a fine example of Brutalist architecture. It's not just me saying that, it's the Heritage Council, the Australian Institute of Architects, now the World Monument Fund.
What does it look like when you look at it, Chris Johnson? You're the former government architect. What do you see when you see Sirius?
I think it's a mistake. It took away the small-scale brick character of the rocks into a concrete high-rise jungle. I find it a really strange quirk that this building has arrived as a response to a whole lot of negative issues. I think this carries that spirit through.
Michelle, what do you think?
I think what you have to look at it is, like, how do we actually make a fair city? And what's the role in government in shaping a market that's going to result in a fair city? So when you look at the housing that must have been there, which they didn't want demolished in the first place, got demolished. They were living in Victorian era houses in different states of disrepair, and that's the fundamental thing. So when you come along with a building like Sirius, which was looking at the technology of the time, looking at things like, you know, running water, bathtubs. You know, we think about these things as kind of givens now. We think, oh, of course you have a bathtub, but that was brand new. That was amazing that you didn't have to go out in the back in the middle of winter and
use the dunny.
It was a really, really important move in the progression of what domestic living meant.
And we also know that, and Chris, you would know this, that architecture works in the contemporary idiom, whatever that contemporary idiom is at the time. So we weren't thinking bricks at that time. Brutalism was the architecture of the government, and that's how we were building our civic building. So it stands to reason that it came about because of that.
I think that's the big problem, though. It wasn't just an ironic. But I think this is the missing link. I think that a few architects comfortably in government were reading the Architects Review and Architects Journal from London about concrete brutalist buildings, totally separate from that community who were not interested in big, bold interventionists from modernism. They wanted to keep the character of the rocks, which is the birthplace of the nation. My belief is that the building, Sirius, represents a modernistic, futuristic, brutal, as the name implies, intervention into that.
When does that change, though, if it represented at the time a modernistic, futuristic perspective of the city that we're expecting, and you say it came from the young architects? It's been, what, 40 years?
Since 40 years.
40 years since it was built. When does that actually shift? When does something actually become embedded into the city? Do you think that it will never have an opportunity, buildings such as this, Brutalist buildings, part of the fabric?
Well, it can in time. I think this broke a number of rules, though. I mean, pushing up above the height of the bridge, I think, was something that was unfriendly relative to the character of the rocks.
I always loved that when I was a kid, when I mentioned that before. It was one thing that I thought was the most remarkable thing about that building.
Well, it's also the reason why I'm in architecture. I was sitting in my grandfather's lap looking over that brow of the bridge, and I can see the Sirius. And in the 70s, we're talking about the future. And you could look at Sirius and you think, wow, that's why I became an architect, because you could then design the future. It was real.
Let's talk about Brutalism more broadly, which of course is an architectural style that emerged in, what was it?
I think it's important just to put a bit of context. Yeah. So when we're talking about European Brutalism as well, especially in places like London that were heavily bombed, we're talking about reconstruction programs in a really depressed economy. We're talking about needing something functional, quick, using new materials. It was really a bit of a child of necessity at that point in time.
And it was also an ethos as well. Yeah. So the Brutalism was more than just an architectural movement. It had a serious social agenda behind it.
Okay. But my feeling is it was all about not hiding the reality of the building. Brutalism is about functionalism, about it's concrete, we're not going to pretend it's not concrete, it's a structure, it's a strong.
Very honest, very raw, and very civic, big, massive civic structures.
Big grey buildings, basically.
Well, big grey buildings. I can understand that aesthetic, I guess, from a theoretical viewpoint. The problem is when it then became theatres on the South Bank of London, if raw concrete around them and things, if it became the police station in Sydney, the government offices in Launceston, which was so arrogant it pushed itself out into the street and the footpath had to wind round and past it. And I think the aim of these was often not to be welcoming, not to be soft, not to be friendly.
It depends on our taste oftentimes, and that's what it comes down to. Shaun, you're quite passionate about this issue. So yeah. Listening to what Chris has to say, what's your take on it?
Well, it's fascinating. Listen to Chris speak, you swear blind, we have Brutalism everywhere. We have so little of it. But I had a boss, a fellow called Tone Wheeler, used to say the High Court of Australia was the second best building in the country. And it really is the build diagram of our democracy. You know, you had the High Court and that has three courts and they float in space in this big volume. And that volume represents the country, and these courts, as they move up through that volume, become more and more powerful. And then what Madigan does, he's the architect, he puts the offices on top of that, and then he puts a roof terrace on top of that. And he says, actually, people stand above all else in the democracy. Mm. So these really fundamental and amazing, you know, architectural gestures that can represent the idea of what and who we are, I think they're really important things.
The High Court's job is to be a bit brutal, to be a bit authoritarian, to be a bit make you feel as though you're a bit smaller when you go into it, that you've got to feel that, gee, I'm entering some big cave type structure here.
There's a lot of MPs feeling pretty small coming out of there these days.
So I can understand a building like that does need that sort of authority about it that can come with a brutalist approach. I think housing, though, is a very different sort of circumstance. My interpretation of Brutalism is that it was a transition phase that was uncomfortable, worked in a few instances, like in bushland settings, and I can understand for a use like either a police station or a high court, it's a pretty good way to demonstrate authority.
Each of you come from architecture backgrounds. Now, I'm not an architect. When I stand in front of Brutalist buildings, and when I was much younger, I didn't get it. I thought they were hideous. And now, through a process of looking and understanding, I start to understand their significance. And yes, some are truly ugly still, but some make sense. And yet, a lot of the times when we hear the criticisms of these buildings from others that are not architects, they're just ugly. There's no point. So I want to just try and address how we can get past what is ugly to move on to what is actually valuable.
I mean, I grew up in Europe, and you know, you'd see buildings like the Brunswick Centre in London, or like the Barbican, and you think, like, what are they doing? And I agree with Chris in the sense that it was very experimental. I mean, there's no doubt about it. But without experimenting in the realm of city making, we would still be stuck in, you know, non-sanitary conditions. I mean, we have really changed the way our cities work for us and the way that we live in them. So I share that point of view in terms of they're not always beautiful, but they are telling a story about how we make representations to one another about what's important to us. And that is always going to be fraught with conflict, because actually the city is inherently a political space.
And it's important that we don't just reduce it down to this very simplistic, hollow and shallow sort of notion of, oh, how pretty is a building and that's why we should keep it. I mean, we wouldn't say that to our children, you know, you're not attractive enough, so therefore don't go on and become a, you know, a this or a that. That's why we have experts that, because remember, once upon a time, we didn't think the Queen Victoria building was attractive. Yeah. And now I think Sydney sides would look at that and go, oh, it's one of our most beautiful buildings. So this idea of prettiness or attractiveness or ugliness comes and goes with time. Yeah. But the important things, it's cultural, social, environmental values, can be, that's why we have things like the Heritage Council that can look into the crystal ball and say, this is important now. It's in its most vulnerable period, the 30 to 60 years of age. Let's hang on to that because it will be valuable and it contains our stories.
Yeah. I mean, my pitch on aesthetics is it's not just an object issue, it's a precinct issue. I think the community reactions about the rocks were about a precinct, not just about individual buildings. It was about trying to keep this original sort of site where Australia's settlement began as a relatively low-rise, friendly brick and, you know, heritage buildings. I think it was against the spirit of what the broader community was looking at.
To wrap up, I want you to name another building that is Brutalist that you love. Just one word, that's it.
I think the Ku'ringai campus.
Ku'ringai campus, Michelle?
I love the Barbican.
Okay, Chris?
I think the campus, where it's in a bushland setting, rugged sandstone, rugged concrete, is a good combination.
Perfect. I like the Barbican too, so I'm going to steal that as well.
There you go. Let's just go to London.
Let's just go to London. Yeah, Shaun Carter, Michelle Tabet, Chris Johnson, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. You're so overpriced.